Sorry. Yeah. Hello, everybody. I'm Virginie Courtier. I'm a researcher in genetics and evolution in Institut Jacques Monod in Paris. And today, so we will investigate together when and where was the first infection in humans. Yeah. So as Sudhir just presented very nicely, so we know that the outbreak started and was first detected in Wuhan in December 19. And we can find the mother of all the genome sequences, which we can call the proximate progenitor. And this virus comes from another virus, which was circulating in a bat population about 50 years ago in southern China. What we don't know is the intermediate events occurring in between. So what is important is to try to go back in time and look at the first infection of humans that we can detect. So to do this, what we need to do is contact tracing. And this is what people have been doing all over the world. And here you can see examples from Taiwan or from Palestine. And so here in our case, what we need to do is called retrospective contact tracing. So we have to look at the earliest cases and then go back in time and find the people they were in interaction with and see whether they were infected by COVID. So the difficulties with retrospective contact tracing with SARS-CoV-2 is that there are asymptomatic individuals. And so the chain of symptomatic individuals is broken by asymptomatics. And so it can be difficult to reconstruct the chain. Another problem, another difficulty is that the symptoms are very similar to flu. And also there is a high variation in a transmission rate between individuals. There are people who will infect 0 person and others 10 and even others 100. So it's really difficult to reconstruct the chain of transmission. And another difficulty is that SARS-CoV-2 is an RNA virus, which is present in infected individuals for a few days. And the RNA is also very unstable. And so if we have samples which were stored, they have to be stored in a freezer at minus 20, otherwise it will be degraded. And even in a freezer over time, it will degrade. And so that's a problem if we want to go back in time. So retrospective tracing. So how can we make sure it was COVID-19? So it can be based on the symptoms, also based on lung images. And for example, you can find ground glass opacities in both lungs, which is a sign of COVID-19. And you can also examine samples. So for example, from the blood, detecting antibodies against the virus. And then you can also find presence of the virus, so in the blood, which is very rare. But in other samples, such as a throat or bronchoalveolar fluid, in a urine, stool, skin. And if you detect the virus, I mean, if you can extract the RNA, then you can sequence it and see whether it corresponds to SARS-CoV-2. You can also detect sometimes SARS-CoV-2 in sewage water, and this is another method. So the problem with these approaches is that they do not, I mean, some of them do not provide a 100% proof that this was indeed COVID-19. Symptoms can be due to other disease as well as for lung images. And when antibodies are detected in the blood, they could be due to another viral infection and to antibodies which recognize other coronavirus. So they are not a definitive proof. And for sewage water, the RNA is in very little quantities, and so it's not possible to fully exclude contamination. So what is more reliable are finding RNA of the virus in the blood and in all these human samples. So what do we know about these early COVID cases? So here, what I mean by early is December 19 or earlier. So our knowledge is based on scientific publications by researchers, on sequences which were deposited in databases. It's also based on the WHO-China joint report, which is up to today the most comprehensive report we have about these early cases. So it's made of two parts, and it's more than 300 pages, and it was released in March 2020. And then we can also use the gray, what is called the gray literature. So newspapers, blogs, video to try to learn more about these early cases. So first, let's look at the ones which are outside of China. So the Global Times is a Chinese newspaper which is under the auspices of the Chinese Communist Party, and they made very nice drawings of early cases outside of China, and so here I took just one of them. And so you can see that in December the outbreak was detected in China, but now if we go back in time, there were cases which were reported in different scientific papers in March in Spain, from September cases in Italy, November in France, Brazil, and the US. However, if you look more closely at these cases, so they correspond to cases where SARS-CoV-2 was detected in wastewater, or based on chest scans, or on the presence of antibodies. And as I just told you previously, in all these cases, we cannot be totally sure. So they are not 100% definitive proof that these correspond to real infection by SARS-CoV-2. So looking at the current literature, there are three studies in which they found a positive RT-PCR, which means a detection of the virus RNA in human samples. And so the first study is a study of a boy from Milan, and the symptoms of this boy started in 21st November 19. So they had a positive RT-PCR, but the sample was degraded, so they could sequence only a small piece, which is 409 base pair long, nucleotide long. And then another study looked at different patients from Lombardy in Italy, and this is a preprint. And they found 13 patients in which they detect the virus RNA. And the earliest sample is from 12 of September. And so here they did a heminested RT-PCR, and they managed to sequence a few pieces of the genome. But still the samples were quite degraded, and so it was not possible to obtain the full genome sequence. And then there is a search study in France, a man living close to Paris. His symptoms started on 27th of December. And here there was a positive RT-PCR, but it was not possible to obtain any sequence from the sample because it was too degraded. So for all these three cases, there are still ongoing discussions in the scientific community, whether they represent real cases or whether they are contaminations. And especially this preprint, it was published in August, and so discussion is still ongoing whether they represent real samples or not. So we cannot conclude for sure about early cases outside of China. So now if we focus on China, when did these early cases occur and when are the first one confirmed? So if we look at the WHO China joint reports, they show that the earliest case is December 8th. So December 8th is the onset date of the symptoms of the person. But now if we look back at this person, actually looking at newspapers and other reports, it seems that the symptoms started at December 16. So maybe there is a problem here. An interesting thing to notice here is that you can see that there are 174 confirmed cases with onset symptoms in December. And 100 of them, like the blue one, are lab confirmed, which means that there was a sample obtained, RNA extracted, and the presence of the virus was detected, presence of virus RNA. And however, up to today, we have only about 20 genomes of these early patients. So it's really unfortunate that we don't have more access to the sequences, as it can be really useful to reconstruct the beginning of the pandemic. So there are different newspapers and blogs which report earlier cases, maybe in November or October, for example, during the Wuhan military games. But these cases are not present in the WHO reports, they are not confirmed, so we are not sure whether they are true cases or not. So about the early cases in China, so where are they found? So there is this interesting paper which makes a review of all the cases. And so here you can see also the number of patients which were confirmed. And in orange, the ones which are living in Wuhan, and the ones in blue and purple are living outside of Wuhan. And so you can see that the first ones are in Wuhan, so the earliest cases. So what is this paper is interesting for several reasons. So the first one is that it's a very extensive review of the early cases in China. The second one is that there is this patient with a disease onset 7th of December, which you can't find here, you know, because it was 8th of December, but maybe it's a false positive. And another interesting thing with this paper is that it was a preprint, which was published in a MedArchive in 11th of February, but then it was retracted 10 days later, and with this new abstract, saying that while the method and the main conclusion in our original analysis remain solid, we decided to withdraw this preprint for the time being, and we will replace it with a more up-to-date version shortly. However, I mean, more than a year and a half later, we still don't have an update of this paper. And it contains information about the location of the patient and information which is not present in the WHO China joint report. So what about these early patients that were detected in Wuhan? So do they have a link to the Wuhan seafood market? So in the WHO China report, they say that the this market was probably a place where the epidemic spread more into the population, but it was not an earlier event. And they also say that there was no verified report of live animals being sold around 2019 in this market. But then, as Alina said in her presentation, I mean, a paper was published in June this year in Scientific Reports. And here they show that actually live mammals were sold in this market, including bamboo rats, marmots, hog badger, and different animals. And so it is possible that these animals were infected and then they infected humans. I mean, so that's a possibility. Another possibility would be that there was a lab accident, and there are many labs in Wuhan which are studying coronaviruses. And as Alina mentioned in our presentation, lab accidents can be due to various scenarios. So first, we are all thinking about a researcher or an employee being infected in a lab, but there are other possibilities. A researcher could also be infected on a bat sampling site, which is not close to the lab. And he could bring back the infection to Wuhan after the trip. Another possibility is that the person who could be first infected would not be related to the lab and would be a person infected by an escaped pathogen from the lab, for example, due to waste water or an air filter failure. So these are things we need to keep in mind if we are thinking about the lab accident. It doesn't always have to be somebody infected within a lab. So what about the labs working in Wuhan on coronavirus? So here is a map of Wuhan, which was made by Rodolphe Demest. And so here you can see as a red dots, all the places where there are labs with BSL 2, 3 or 4 labs, which are high biosafety labs. And the ones with a coronavirus scheme represent labs which are working on coronaviruses. So you can see the Wuhan Institute of Virology, which was mentioned a lot in the press. And so here is a site where they host their BSL4 lab. But this is a new site and the old site is here. So there are two sites for the Wuhan Institute of Virology and they are handling coronaviruses. And coronaviruses are also handled in other places in Wuhan University here and also in the Wuhan CDC. And what is interesting to note also is that the CDC moved from this place to this place, which is very close to the Yunnan seafood market around December 2019. So really close to when the outbreak was detected in this area.
Great, thanks.
And so now if we look at where the early cases in Wuhan are found, so this is adapted from a recent paper published in Cell, which was even adapted from the WHO China joint report. So here the red dots correspond to each patient whose disease onset was between 8 and 16 of December. And here you see the position of the Wuhan Institute of Virology, the two sites, and also the position of the Wuhan CDC and the Yunnan market. So here I also included the location of the 8 December case. So based on other reports and medical reports and newspapers, This case is based around here in this region, and it was not indicated in this paper, nor in the WHO joint report. And so here you can notice that the known early cases are found close to the Yunnan market, but also close to the Wuhan CDC. And there are also rumors and newspapers and intelligence data indicating that there were a few people, maybe three people from Wuhan Institute of Virology who were sick in November 2019, but we don't have further data on these cases. So in conclusion, so there is ongoing discussion in the scientific community about the 2019 cases outside of China. So there are several papers published, but so far nobody is, there is no consensus about this data and whether they represent genuine cases of SARS-CoV-2 infection. When were these early patients first detected? So we know that the earliest confirmed cases in China are in December. Earlier, we have newspapers and other records, but nobody's fully sure. We have genomes available, and based on the genomes, we can see that there are already two or three mutations between these early genomes. So this indicates that the virus was circulating before December, and as Sudhir presented, we, based on the genome sequences, we can infer that the virus, the progenitor of the virus was already present in October or November. We know that there was a large outbreak detected in Wuhan, and there is still ongoing discussion about where was the first human infected. Was it in the market? Was it associated with a lab accident? Which animals were did they got the virus? Can we imagine other sources? So this is still unclear. So what we need to do is further investigate possible cases outside of China. So in our group, we are trying to get more blood samples and urine samples from France, from hospitals, and we hope we can test them and find a new, identify other cases. What I think is really important is also to update the WHO China joint reports and have a better, up-to-date version. We need to continue investigating the early cases and their possible interactions with each other, because so far we don't know their link, and maybe it would be better if we can go back in time and test back their family if they had any samples collected. What would be good is to obtain additional sequences from these early samples, and then we need to also develop new tools and new methods to examine these early sequences and learn more about the beginning. And I would like to thank the Drastic team, as they've done a lot of work and they can dig a lot of data, and it's extremely useful for everybody and even, all the community and the research community, and in particular Francisco for all his work on early patients, and Rodolphe for the map of the BSL4 labs in Wuhan. And I also would like to thank the users of Twitter, as it's a really good platform to exchange ideas and arguments. And also I would like to thank the participants of our monthly workshop, where we discuss the different data and we confront different hypotheses. And thank you for your attention.